mean,
a little phallic.
Is there anything more fun than bubble wands?
You do this quite a bit. This is actually, is it odd to be on the other side of the camera?
I guess I should check, right? Usually I'm in your seat. Yes, it's very weird to be here with the lights.
I don't see any lettuce or anything.
That's good.
Is it odd? I mean, are you comfortable on that side of the camera? Because you've certainly done a lot of interviews in the last number of years.
Yes, but never. I always prefer to be in your seat. Definitely.
So how long did this particular journey take?
An entire lifetime. I grew up 10 minutes away from Tahrir, so I've mm-hmm. been, you know, thinking about and caring about Egypt for a long time as an Egyptian. I made a film in 2007 called Egypt, We're Watching You, about the activist movement in 2005-06. And that was released on BBC and worldwide as part of a series called Why Democracy. And then this film really started, no pre-production to speak of. It started in January 2011. There were rumblings of people gathering, as you know, on a huge protest because it was Police Day, so a celebration of Police Day. So since so many people have been badly tortured and abused by the police, there was a huge movement. And earlier that year, in June of 2011, somebody named Khaled Said was brutally tortured and killed in prison. So people had come down to the streets in massive numbers earlier that year. So we knew that January 25th, 2011 was going to be big. We just didn't know whether it was going to last, because many times you're surrounded by police, people are beaten, sent to jail, and then people go home. But in this case, people came back, and then came back to the square, and then stayed and sat in. And they're sitting in a square that is at the center of all of the main government buildings, you know, mm-hmm. so in effect, occupying that square, you're covered by news cameras. You know, this is why squares around the world work, why occupying squares and staying there, why that is able to make a statement that actually affects things.
So how did you start? I mean, what was the, did you just guys take a few cameras? Was it
no,
so, cams?
Was it? So I was in Egypt at the time. I'd been there for a few months. And I actually had a choice leading up to January 25th of whether I wanted to be in the square. And I knew there'd be a lot of cameras and following the protests, mm-hmm. or in Davos. I was invited to go there, and I knew that I could possibly get access to the leadership of Egypt as things were exploding. So I thought that would be kind of an interesting place to be. So mm-hmm. I decided to go to Davos, but made the wrong decision because nobody showed up. Of course, because things got a lot bigger very quickly. And so I tried to get back to Egypt as quickly as I could. I was talking to friends of mine on the ground who said that anything that looks like a camera is being confiscated or destroyed. So, and they won't let, if you arrive in the airport, they'll take away anything that looks like video equipment. But you can get in with the 5D cameras, or the 6D, because they're allowing photography cameras in. Mm-hmm. So I stopped in London, picked up a 60D, mm-hmm. landed, left the airport, and had a number of copies of the previous film that I'd made, because I was giving them out to characters, the film was called Egypt. Do you want to stop with this, or we can keep
It's actually the Egyptian
going.
Government has managed to send somebody here.
You're disrupting our conversation.
To take care of it.
I don't even know where I was.
We were talking about getting in. You got some camera. You got some still cameras.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
Video cameras. And
yeah.
You went home. You went back to Egypt.
Yeah. So I got there. My regular large camera was confiscated, but it was a blessing in disguise, because the footage that comes from these DSLR cameras was absolutely beautiful. Yeah. So we left the airport. The military at that point had come down to the streets to try to take control of the situation. So there were checkpoints all along the way between the airport and my house. And I was trying to get to the square as quickly as possible. So I was stopped about 20 minutes outside the airport. Car was searched, and they found these old DVDs from my previous film called Egypt, We're Watching You, which was not a good title of a film to find, as the country's exploding by military intelligence. So I didn't know who it was at the time, but they took me into a sort of nondescript location. I saw a lot of blindfolded people being taken into rooms, and I was questioned for a number of hours. And I didn't know what they were getting at or who they were. So I was being very careful with what I was saying. And at a certain point, I was able to get the DVDs and I tried to destroy them. I don't know if you've ever tried to break a DVD, but it's kind of hard. And so I tried to shove it down a drain, continued the interrogation, and the guy who was cleaning the bathroom walks in with this piece of the DVD, you know, saying, "I found the evidence." And so I said, "Yes, I made a film three years ago. Mm-hmm. It was about women who I believe were fighting for important change in Egypt, as everybody is now." The person who I found out later was military intelligence said, "You know, do you really think that those people in the square represent all of Egypt?" And I said, "No, but, you know, it doesn't take a whole country to change a country. It takes a dedicated few," which is something that I would learn in the future. We actually had quite an interesting conversation. He let me go, and I went directly to the square, where I found men, women, religious, secular, all different classes. It was an incredible sight to see and to be a part of. It was this magical feeling of people taking their lives and their country into their own hands and basically saying, you know, no more. We don't want to have kids in this country. We don't want to continue living without trying to change it. So I wanted to film it because that's, you know, you experience something magical, you immediately want to share that magic with the rest of the world. Incredibly inspiring, you know, people who, if they got taken to prison, would be there for the rest of their lives. I went there also with somewhat of a cynicism because I'd marched against the Iraq war, nothing had happened, and so I was sort of waiting for the time when the tanks would come in and everybody would be carted off to prison.
You marched against it in Egypt or marched against
it? No,
the
I marched against it in the States.
In the States.
Yeah.
You know, we don't stay in the square very long here.
We didn't. It was a march, you know, there were thousands and thousands of people in the streets. I mean, you know, so to see nothing happen in this country, this amazing country where people power changes everything, you know, and you really have a fear that nothing's going to happen when, you know, I went back home to Egypt where there hasn't been such this history, the strong history of the civil rights movement and people power. And so to see the change happen was absolutely incredible. Never imagined it. But in terms of the filmmaking, quickly started to look for characters that I wanted to be with. And you know, when you make a film, you look for people that you fall in love with, that you want to share with the world. And the film gods were with us, and we were all sleeping in a square in tents, and so all the characters were basically sleeping in other tents near me. Met Ahmed, the main character of the film, who has this, you know, joy and hope and vision for what he wants his country to be. I just got very attached to him right away and wanted to follow him. Met Magdi, the Muslim Brotherhood character, and we basically started following about six characters to start with, and then it narrowed down.
Is there a we? I mean, I use all the time, but so, I mean, at this point, have you brought a team in, or?
A we, I mean, this is the most collaborative film I've ever worked on. There was no pre-production. We all met each other in the square. Our DP, Hamdi Karim, our producer, we were all there, I guess, first as Egyptians and protesters, and then secondly, we all met and decided to make a film together. It wasn't the kind of thing where you could hire somebody to put themselves in that situation.
Right. So did you give them the same kind of camera? Did you get more cameras? Did they have their own cameras? Because it does look like there's a mix of formats in the film.
It's all shot with DSLRs, so Hamdi had his own camera and actually taught us. He saw the way that we were using it. It was the first time I'd ever used this kind of camera, and he was like, "Your white balance is all wrong, you're shooting at the wrong speed, like you need a lesson, sit down." And so we sat in the tents, and he taught myself and Cressida, who was another one of the photographers on the film, and she was... she ended up marrying Khaled Abdullah, one of the lead characters in the film, who was also the lead in The Kite Runner. And Khaled is an interesting character as well, because he's somebody who, you know, during very confusing times, he was incredibly articulate. And he could have been anywhere in the world. You know, he has an incredible acting career, but he chose to basically be in the square over the last 2.5 years. So I met Cressida, his wife, and she decided to join the team. And so this gave us incredibly intimate access to Khalid, because I don't know whether he thought that he would be waking up with a camera in the morning, you know, but it
better
it,
than the secret police.
Right. Exactly. Having your wife film,
yes,
definitely.
Over you when you wake up.
So yeah, so Hamdi taught us all how to use the cameras. Ahmed picked up a camera midway through the shooting, the character, and he ended up shooting a quarter of the film, and he became a fantastic filmmaker. So the whole process of making this film was both, you know, so many people, our sound guys were protesters in the square who learned how to use the sound equipment. So it was very much a learning experience, and our office that we got 5 minutes from the square became somewhat of a school as we were editing this film.
Well, I noticed you have a lot of editors listed on the film.
We do. This was a long process, and, you know, it was a difficult process editing a film about that, you know, about something that is continually changing. But it's been the most rewarding thing I've ever worked on, because we're making something and we're releasing something right now that can affect things on the ground. We're showing the film to people that are writing the Constitution. Mm. People are looking at the film as this, you know, it's a document of, you know, what happened the last 2.5 years, when a lot of these narratives sometimes get shoved under the carpet and ignored. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll tell you what Ahmed said to me when we made the shortlist is, he said, you know, this is a battle of the narratives. And he said, he's like, I can't believe that we've made it here. It means that our story will never be wiped away. It'll never be ignored. It's out there now. So no matter what happens, this struggle that we've been on and that we're continuing to be on, the fight for freedom of expression and human rights and social change and democratic change in Egypt is ongoing. And so it's so important to see the reality and the very human stories behind that struggle.
But one, I mean, the picture premiered at Sundance, I believe, last year. So it's almost a full year since then. And then there was no distributor until this summer, I guess.
We didn't actually go after when it screened at Sundance,
right.
As we were on the way to Sundance, our characters were all back in the streets again. I mean, 2 weeks beforehand. So the story changed. It went from the story about the bringing down of a dictator to the election of a new president to a much more interesting story, because when our characters were back in the streets fighting against Morsi, who was the Brotherhood president, who was using the tools of democracy to create another dictatorship, all of our characters were basically saying, no, this is about holding your leadership accountable no matter who they are. And so the story became about the fight against fascism, whether the face of that fascism is Mubarak or the military or the Muslim Brotherhood. So right after Sundance, we went back and we just continued filming and editing for the next almost 8 months, and then relaunched the film at Toronto. But we knew that we wouldn't be able to have a distributor come on at Sundance and release it, because the film had not ended yet.
But I mean, was there a rush of people who were wanting to? I mean, it's an interesting thing, because it feels like Netflix now, and really CNN Films, new division in the last 6-8 months, are kind of a great fit for a film like this, and that those distribution arms didn't really exist even a year ago.
We had three offers for distribution, but they were theatrical offers, and you know, it's tough, because it's not recommended to filmmakers to go release your film at Sundance and go back and re-edit it, and you know, but it was, you know, it was, do we make a film? We're making a film that needs to stand the test of time 50 years, 100 years from now, and this is the reality of what's happening on the ground, and we need to get this story right. So it didn't really feel completely finished until we took it to Toronto.
Well, it really is like a full new third act. I mean,
yeah. Exactly.
And I assume you had three acts. I didn't see the film, unfortunately, at Sundance last year, but I assume you kind of went back and compressed what you had. And then
we did, and stylistically it changed a great deal as well. We really went in and overhauled the whole film.
So is that window, I mean, we're talking to the woman who made Blackfish, who was very excited in part because on CNN they had a million plus viewers or multi-million viewers, and that impact on SeaWorld would be more direct than, say, doing a theatrical and having, you know, doing $500,000 and then doing a DVD distribution. I mean, is the Netflix opportunity one that actually expands the universe and actually makes the film more widely accessible?
Well, we think so. We think that they're the right partner because it was so important to get it to as wide and diverse an audience as possible, and we felt Netflix really brought that. So that's why we went with them.
They seem to be very passionate about it.
They are. They really are. I mean, we couldn't be happier actually with the partnership.
So you went back to Egypt. Was there any resistance to you on your way back?
When I went back
to shoot again.
Oh, to shoot again. No, it's you know, we've had our office there, which is about 5 minutes away from the square.
Right.
We just, you know, we continued shooting. It was a lot. Actually, it was a lot easier to film this last chapter because there is, you know, I mean, in the first chapter, you know, the first sort of half of the film is dealing with a lot of the, you know, the army and what the army is doing to the people, mm-hmm. and it's a lot more difficult to stand up against an army who is taking your footage and smashing your cameras than it is to stand up against the Brotherhood. Although it is more confusing because when people are fighting against people, it can be difficult to tell who's who, you know.
That's interesting. So it's the argument that I mean, there is a sense of a slightly more relaxed shoulder line, I guess, from people as they're dealing with the idea of trying to get Morsi out. So that's pervasive. That is really just how it felt. Even though it was considered oppressive on some level, it wasn't considered quite as dangerous?
It didn't feel as dangerous, although I will say that before we went down to shoot the, you know, there was this huge protest that happened on the 30th, you know, described by some newscasters as the largest protest in the history of mankind that went down against Morsi. And right before that protest happened, there were a lot of threats that there were going to be, you know, car bombs that would go off. And, you know, so actually that was, now that I think back on it, that was actually a nerve-wracking time to go down and shoot. But none of that happened. It was all sort of the Brotherhood PR machine, I think, dissuading people from going down. And then once we were down and filming, it you know, wasn't dangerous at all. You know, I think people came down to the streets in such vast numbers because they were deeply offended by the fact that, you know, in one scene in the film, you see that Morsi is in a huge stadium and there are people that are speaking, you know, alongside him. And one of the speakers stands up and says, you know, anybody that goes down to the street should be punished to be standing against, you know, our leadership. And you are a kafir, you are not Muslim if you go down to the streets. And so people were, you know, it's a deeply religious country, but it's privately religious. And people basically said, you know, we will not have a leadership that will use religion, you know, to threaten us and who we are and our rights to protest and our rights to, you know, fight for our for human rights and dignity and all of the things that we fought for when we got rid of Mubarak, to watch somebody. And there was also this feeling like, okay, well, the army did this and that and Mubarak did this and that, but they weren't elected. We elected you guys.
Right.
Like, you know, live up to this. And so I think that this is where the real outpouring came, because they also felt like there was a change in the country, you know. This is the tip of the iceberg, but ballet was being banned, you know, protest was being banned. You know, there were kinds of things like this where, you know, the majority of Egyptians did not want to see their country change that way. So, so capturing that final chapter, though, I think that the most important part of this final chapter, though, was watching the friendship between Ahmed and Maghdi, because even though they were driven apart and they, you know, they began together as people that had experienced this magical moment where they felt like anything was possible, and by the end of the film you see that their friendship remains strong, but they've been driven apart by politics as Maghdi goes to the Muslim Brotherhood protest and Ahmed is, you know, in the square in the midst of the celebrations, you know, as the Brotherhood protest is being attacked, and they talk with each other, and you have to see the film to find out.
It feels
rest,
like Magdi kind of got sucked back in.
He did, because,
you know, it's like he was so verbal about not being part of the Brotherhood and disagreeing with what the Brotherhood did and being very open about it, and then all of a sudden he's kind of back with them.
Well, it just shows you the power of martyrdom. You know, it shows you the power of you know, when the Brotherhood was out in the open and when they were given the chance to, you know, run for office, mm-hmm. They were, you know, what was fascinating was over the last, you know, 50 years, the Brotherhood had gained such power among the Egyptian people because they took on a lot of the, you know, social services that the government mm-hmm. was not taking on. So without one political post, they gained such power among the people. And then once they came into power, it took them 1 year to lose all their, you know, all their popularity. Yeah. So this was very interesting to see. And Megdi, though, you know, he said, "I don't agree with Morsi, but I'm going to the protest because I need to protect the women and the children that are there." And it just shows you that, you know, once when people are in power and it's allowed to run, just like any other politician, mm-hmm. you know, even Brotherhood members like Megdi are saying, "He's just a corrupt, dirty politician like the rest of them. He's just using religion, you know." And then the minute that they're shoved underground and massacred by, they're given a kind of, the group is given a kind of power and a kind of, when martyrs are made, when those images are on TV, you know, mm-hmm. not only is it a horrible thing that happened at this Brotherhood sit-in, but it also gives them a power that they didn't have.
Mm. It is amazing how quickly everybody becomes the same. When they have the opportunity to,
right?
It's one of those strange phenomena of mankind. It really, I mean, it's oddly when Mandela dying this last couple of weeks, you know, one of the few people who didn't turn, and it's one of the things that's most powerful about his story is that, you know, once they finally got power, they didn't become, you know, white people killers. They didn't, you know, go out and take revenge. They actually tried to run the country.
That's right. Well, this is where, I mean, at the end of the film, Ahmed says, you know, this is about building a society of conscience, you know, and this is what's happening in squares, you know, around the world. This is about the zeitgeist of our time. It's not only about a square in Egypt. And so, you know, tangibly, that consciousness is about creating a constitution that, respects the rights of everybody. But it's also about fighting for a different kind of social contract with your government. And that is happening all around the world. And actually, one of the most incredible screenings that we've had have been in high schools. Some of the most incredible screenings we've had have been in high schools. And, you know, kids have come up to us at the end of screenings and have said, you know, we never watched the news about the Middle East or followed what's happened in Egypt. But to me, this story is about fighting for change and fighting for what you believe in and the dedication it takes and the patience it takes. And this is about the civil rights movement of our time. And so it made me start to think about what I'm actually doing for what I believe in and what I'm actually doing to change, you know, the situation that I'm living in. So that was actually a really exciting moment when we heard from sort of U.S. high school students that this was about something that they could deeply connect to.
It was very identifiable in many ways. And one of the things that was fascinating about the film is watching how civilly they argue within the group. You know, they really disagree strongly. There are a lot of factions within the group, and yet holding it together and being kind to one another, you know, and even if they hate the other person's ideas, is another thing that's rare and fascinating about this.
I feel so, you know, blessed really and grateful that I was able to be a witness to what's happened over the past 3 years, because it really was like witnessing the civil rights movement of our time, or, you know, witnessing the founding of a country again. Mm-hmm. And watching people experience what it means to have free debate, live in front of you. I mean, imagine I grew up in a country where if you asked people political questions, the taxi driver or whatever, people wouldn't answer for fear of who they were talking to. And, you know, Khaled says this beautifully when he talks about a taxi driver that he was talking to at the time in Egypt, when people were going down to protest against Morsi. And he said, you know, my feeling is it's you either take me or you take me and my kids and my grandkids and my grandkids' kids, so it's better you just take me.
So how did you know you were done?
That's the hardest decision to make as a filmmaker, always. But we had followed, by the time we finished this last round of filming in July of this year, we had filmed an entire arc of our characters having fought against every regime and person that had come into power that had been trying to take the rights away from people. Mm-hmm. So we felt like our characters had gone through an entire cycle and we were really following their story. Mm-hmm. And it became a complete story about holding government accountable, no matter who they are. And that was the story of this film.
So a lot of nights at dinner having that argument with each other about, you know,
well,
we're there, we're not there.
The story continues, the revolution mm-hmm. continues, the Constitution, you know, there was just a protest law banning protests that was issued, you know, 2 weeks ago, and all of our characters were back in the streets, you know, mm-hmm. fighting, protesting against this protest law. And, you know, 24 of them were arrested, or I think more actually, but Ida was one of them. And then they're looking at this protest law again, which just shows that it doesn't take 80 million people to change a country. It takes a dedicated few to keep pushing against the system and keep, you know, demanding that this change happens.
There's that great line about, we've taught them how to protest. We've taught them how to be revolutionary. And that,
right.
you know, once they know how, then they can all do it themselves.
And his hope in the future is the fact that, I mean, the generation, the youth of Egypt and in many countries in the Arab world going through this change, I think it's something like a huge percentage. The majority of the country is under 40. Mm. So these new ideas are taking hold and really changing, you know, deeply changing the country. So I actually have great optimism for the future because of the kinds of people that I followed and the staying power of this struggle. And so anything that, you know, we feel very, you know, we're one film that's going to come out about this, and there's going to be many more films and thousands of books that are going to be written about this. But what's really important, I think, is to try to give voice to people that are continually silenced, and they're being silenced right now, but they're struggling to get the word out there and continue to fight and continue to push, and this film is a part of that struggle.
There's an interesting beat in the film, and I guess that the length of it is helpful in this regard, is great in this regard, where they're first kind of realizing that Morsi is not what they really want, and that it's a problem again, and they're going to have to go through the same thing again. And you kind of, there's the woman who argues back about whether you're just complaining for the sake of complaining, and everybody bitches about the president and all that. And then, you know, as the country embraces it, it kind of reminds you again that they're not just malcontents who are going to complain about every person who comes and tries to run the country.
Well, it was interesting watching this group of people that we followed. Even they're from very different backgrounds. I mean, Khaled is from a very different background as Megdi, who's from a very different background as Ahmed. And yet they are always on the forefront of change. And that can be a very lonely position. And so I think that's why we've had some incredible activist support from here and from around the mm-hmm. world, because it really shows you what it means to be standing on that edge of change, continually pushing it, and you just have the trust that the rest of the country is going to get to where you are at some point. But at times it's very lonely, and nobody sees the Martin Luther King or the Gandhi or the Nelson Mandela when they're completely alone and they have no support mm-hmm. and they think that they may have failed. But the most important thing is that they go back the next day. And that staying power allows for people to join in. And that's the position or the role that the people that we followed play. So we felt like we were really telling a story about both the success and the loneliness and the darkness of activism and the kind of patience and dedication that it takes to stick with your principles no matter what the consequences are.
And after this fairly historically short time, as they say, as you say in the movie, 2 years is not enough to change the really change everything.
In 2.5 years, they've given a major blow to a, you know, a military regime, a
their world
Muslim
has changed.
Brotherhood, a 30-year dictatorship.
But they haven't gotten necessarily what they're. Is there a sense of what? Obviously, a philosophical one, but is there a literal sense of the idea of what a happy outcome of this looks like? Or leadership that they think may be the people that should be leading the country? Or,
well, I think that where you get to in the characters is, and this is something that we can relate to in the United States, it went from like, you know, yes, we can, to like, yes, he can, you know, with Obama, right? Mm-hmm. And it's not, that's not the way that change happens, right? The change happens because you have a committed, involved citizenry that continues to fight and continues to push. And, you know, we've experienced that in the civil rights movement. Like, were all of the laws put into place, you know, during the civil rights movement that people were fighting for? No. People are still fighting for some of those laws, but there was a consciousness.
Racism is over, according to the Supreme Court.
But a consciousness was changed, you know? Yeah. And that's the same, that's what we experienced in Egypt, is that a kind of, there's been a consciousness that has changed and that is continuing to evolve.
So that's really, the hope is in the people, not the specific leader or the group of people who are.
I think that, and that's where our characters get to, and that's a, you know, that's a universal theme that's happening in the world right now. It really is. It's not some leader that is, as Ahmed says at the end of the film, there's no leader that's going to come in from the heavens and save the day. And we're trying to get away from that in Egypt. We've always had the pharaoh, you know, that has come in and ruled Egypt. And something that we hoped to do with this film and that's happening is show the power of individual leadership, you know, show the Rosa Parks of Egypt, because that's what inspires kids, to know that as an individual you can actually make a change.
And what about yourself? Do you now go to a beach somewhere? Maybe a beach is inappropriate. To the water somewhere and relax for a while, or are you just jamming along?
Jamming along, not for a while, but, you know, hopefully soon, a week at the beach. I don't know what I'd do with myself, actually. You know, after being on high adrenaline for the last 3 years, I don't know. I would have to do some kind of like, a beach would be nice.
Is there consistency in how the next thing shows up for you, or do you just, sometimes it shows up when you're going home anyway, or?
No, I mean, you mean the next project?
Yeah.
I'm writing something right now. We also filmed 1600 hours of footage, and there's a couple of short pieces that we want to make. We want to do, we want to be able to release this film, and then people are very curious about the ongoing nature of what's happening on the ground. So we're working right now on being able to update people. We're not a news channel, but there are a couple of pieces that we want to do about what's happening now. Because we feel like, and it's been incredibly powerful to have the support of people here and around the world for this film, and you know, with the articles that have come out, and, you know, now you guys are part of the revolutionary forces, and, you know, the short list, and, you know, it gives a sort of support to this narrative and this story that is so important right now in order to get the film out in Egypt. And that's what we're working on now, is we're waiting for the film to pass censorship, because it's so crucially important that this film is shown as widely as possible in Egypt and across the Arab world right now.
So you're not going to make a documentary about McDonald's or...
Not right now.
Candy or...
No. No, this is the most deeply personal story or film that I've ever worked on. It was, you know, it's about a revolution on the outside and showing people what it was, you know, what it was to be in the revolution. Our hope was to be able to translate that experience to people of what it felt like to be watching a revolution live. But that revolution wasn't only on the outside for people. It was also a revolution on the inside, because when your understanding of possibility changes, and as I said at the beginning of this very long half an hour, you know, when I went there, I really was a skeptic. I wasn't sure things would change. And when things began to change, and it was because of an, you know, an incredible people's movement and a sticking to your principles and a kind of refusal to back down. It was just my whole understanding of possibility and what people could do as a collective changed. And when your understanding of what's possible changes in one area, it changes in your whole life, your ideas of possibility of family and work and, you know, everything changes. And so, and that was not only my experience, I think it was the experience of everybody in that square and everybody who worked on this film.
So you come into it with a sophistication, having been a person of the world, not just of Egypt, but certainly of Egypt and elsewhere. And your sounds like your cynicism that was built into being sophisticated kind of slipped away.
Definitely. Definitely. You know, I mean, I'd like to say that I still have a sort of, you know, a healthy kind of questioning of things. Mm-hmm. But what this gave me was, you know, a real ability to hope about things and to believe in things. You know, that I guess, you know, 10 years in New York did a job on.